had a problem this morning.
What problem?
The one you're looking at. The ion temperature discrepancy.
No big deal. Here, have a look. The ions show a drift rotating around the arc, you see? It's a minor anomaly. Next time, we just have to prepare a magnetic blowout as a backup quench.
Well, if the temperature anomalies were great enough, and the lifetime's long enough, it could, under the right conditions, start a runaway chain reaction. Now, think about that on a nuclear scale.
Come on, Ken, that's an enormous leap in logic. Besides, we stopped worrying about runaways 40 years ago, or hadn't you heard? Oh, I see. More fuel for your anti-nuke fire?
I am seriously concerned, Alex.
And I'm sorry to disappoint you, Ken. But the kinds of temperatures necessary for anything like that are highly improbable.
But what if?
No offense, pal, but resorting to scare tactics in support of the nuclear freeze is irresponsible, not to mention poor science. I gotta go.
What about checking the computer data for temperature anomalies on the atmospheric blasts of the 50s and early 60s?
That's not a bad idea. All right, I'll set it up. You satisfied?
Ask me that after we've seen the data.
Out that the arms talks were sabotaged by both sides as a pretext for testing their EMP weapons. They've been looking for an excuse for years.
What on earth are EMP weapons?
Electromagnetic pulse.
What?
Star Wars weapons that destroy the enemy's command and control microcircuitry and orbiting communication satellites. The truth is, they destroy all types of electronics in a matter of milliseconds. It's the new strategic toy, my dear.
Sorry I asked.
Alex!
Yuri!
Hahali!
Hey, good to see you.
Good to see you, Alex.
May I present my wife, Diane? Yuri Laporta.
My pleasure. How do you do, Mrs. Carmody? I'm most pleased to meet the wife of such a brilliant scientist.
Oh.
You and Alex have worked together?
Not really. We've just endured a few boring conferences together.
I tell you, they're far less boring in your husband's company. So, Alex, how are your experiments going?
I'm afraid we had to shut down today. We developed a temperature anomaly without a backup quench.
Sorry to hear that.
There's some people I want you to meet. Dr. Laporta?
Nice to see you.
See you later, Yuri.
What on earth was that about?
That was the opposition. Here, the chairman will clear.
You meet him, thanks. I'm going to find a neutral corner.
Shake him.
Is this where the hopelessly bored hang out?
If you mean the social misfits, yeah.
May I have a Jack Daniels and water, please?
Cigarette?
Yeah, thank you. Well, you don't look like you belong to this crowd.
You're very perceptive. I get invited to these things as kind of local color. I do my best to live up to it.
Thank you. Well, at least you look more comfortable than I feel.
You're not as perceptive as I thought. Now, look at those guys, please. They sure know how to have fun.
Honey, come here. Joe and my wife, Diane.
Hi.
Hello.
I hope I haven't monopolized Alex too much.
Oh, not at all. Usually by this time, he's so bored, he's asleep in the car.
It's true.
Honey, don't you think we ought to go? It's getting kind of late.
Yeah, sure.
Can we give you a lift, Joe?
Oh, no, thanks. I live just around the corner. Look, if you're in the neighborhood, why don't you give me a call?
Thanks, I will. You're a priest.
Relax. You don't look like a physicist.
How'd you know I was?
I don't know. I don't read Newsweek.
Obviously. It was a real pleasure.
It was mine. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Morning, folks.
Good morning.
Just in time, Kent.
How's it going?
Good. Here's the menu.
Let's begin with hardtack and scan for EMP and other blast effects.
Any preference?
Try Teak. It's the high-altitude blast.
Good place is any.
What
What's this? Red spot.
No idea. Jackie, give us a graph on the spherical wave.
Look, this is all very interesting, but I've got a plane to catch. What about the ion temperature readings?
I'll check.
No dice. They assume the ion temperatures would be the same as the electrons.
What about the other tests?
Hang on a second. Okay. This is the orange and starfish prime test. It's the same on all of them, not measured.
Well, it seems like a good idea. Sorry to waste your time. I've got to go.
Where are you off to?
New York. I have a speech to make, remember?
Oh, yeah. You're really going through with that.
Sure, all he needs is a cross and some nails.
Flattery will get you everything.
I hear we're getting network news coverage. Who knows? I might even get a series out of it. You wish me luck?
No. Good luck.
Good luck, yeah.
Want to wrap it up?
No, not yet. Let's go back to the teak blast for a minute. I want to see that red spot again. Let's find out what we got on the artificial aurora.
Here we are. Look at that.
Jackie, let's cross-reference any other artificial auroras or red spots.
Yeah, what are we looking for?
I don't know. Indulge me.
Okay.
When is this? 1938?
It's the only other artificial aurora in the memory.
Is there any background? Fatima. As in Our Lady of...
What is that?
Some Catholic grade school stuff. Let's see what's in the memory. Yeah, that's it, all right. Forget it.
Shall I order the background articles up?
Me and the computer must be grasping for straws. Let's see a graph comparison on the red spots.
The teak blast and the 1938 of all.
Yeah.
See any difference?
Other than the size, no.
Maybe I should order up the background articles on Fatima.
If you want to.
Can't wait.
So why is it so funny?
How can you take it seriously? Three Portuguese peasant children chatting with the Virgin Mary? Come on, Brian. Not the most reliable witnesses.
Yeah, but somebody must have thought it was important enough to put it into the computer.
What were the prophecies all about?
I don't know.
Jackie's going to dig up some background material for me, but I think it's a waste of time. I mean, even if the aurora was predicted, which I doubt, what's it got to do with ion temperatures and a fusion experiment?
Well, I guess you won't know till you check it out, right?
Hey, who's the physicist here? You just throw the ball, and yeah, I'll check it out. Come on, throw me along with it. Come on.
What's up, honey?
Alex, you better come on home. Nat Weiss has been trying to reach you for the last hour. No, I just got back from town, and there are about 5 messages from him on the machine.
You must have found out I left early, huh?
No, honey, this is serious. I called the office and I talked to Sheila. Apparently, it's something about Ken.
Ken, is he okay?
Well, apparently he said something in a speech that the network's picked up. And on that wise, he's gone to the local TV studios to do an interview with the network news.
Oh, Ken's an idiot. I should have talked him out of making it.
Well, listen, honey, if we hurry, we'll just catch the broadcast. Okay.
Yet from the Russian foreign minister, a no comment from the U.S. Secretary of State. Nuclear arms were also the subject of a speech by noted physicist Dr. Kenneth Parrish. Dina Roberts has that story.
Dr. Kenneth Parrish shocked a huge crowd here at Madison Square Garden with a startling revelation in the speech this afternoon. Speaking before a nuclear freeze rally, Dr. Parrish told them,
because a terrible new generation of weapons, 50 megatons, 100 megatons, is now upon us. And soon, even these will be eclipsed by the weapons we are working on today. The madness must stop. Because based on the very recent work of an associate of mine, there is a possibility that a single missile or bomb could set in motion an unlimited nuclear chain reaction that would, in effect, ignite the atmosphere. creating a nuclear tornado and almost certain destruction of the Earth.
At the press conference after the rally, Dr. Parrish refused to comment any further on the experiments which might have indicated this potential catastrophe. Dina Roberts, at Madison Square Garden, here in New York.
Thank you, Dina. Dr. Parrish is employed by the Spring Valley National Research Laboratories in Massachusetts. Its chief administrator, Dr. Nathan Wise, has kindly consented to speak to Network News. Good evening, Dr. Wise. Were you aware in advance of the statements Dr. Parrish would make in his speech this afternoon?
No, I certainly wasn't.
Would you have stopped him if you had been?
Stopped him? No, but I most surely would have tried to dissuade him.
Why?
Because it isn't true.
You're saying that Dr. Parrish lied?
No, of course not. I just think he overreacted to a minor experimental anomaly and jumped to an old, long-discarded conclusion.
I'm not sure I follow you.
Doctors Fermi and Teller, consider the possibility of such a chain reaction occurring during the early days of the Manhattan Project. At that time, they found enough conclusive evidence to the contrary to shove the theory aside. And it looks as if they were right, doesn't it? 40 years later, we're still here, aren't we?
Thank you, Dr. Wise. Next, when we get back, a strange story with an unusually happy ending. But first, these...
Goodbye, Dr. Parrish.
Dr. Carmody, just a minute, please. There's a meeting going on.
What should have been a...
Excuse me, gentlemen, but since it appears I'm implicated in this indiscretion, I'd like to know what's going on.
It's a bit more than an indiscretion, Alex. We treat breaches of security seriously here. You know that. There'll be a formal review, of course. Beyond that, I can't say. Now, if you don't mind. Alex. It was a stupid thing for Ken to do. You know that. We don't need that kind of publicity.
If you say so, but come on. There's been no security breach.
Alex, right now, the boy's on the top floor. Real edgy. Come down on me with both feet, so I don't need you piling on.
Wait a second. You know that we're prepared to rerun that experiment to its conclusion this time and prove to everyone's satisfaction that there's nothing to it or that there is.
I'm telling you, I want you to stay out. I'll let the board decide how they want to proceed. Best thing for you to do now is go home. Right now, all I want to know is where the hell Ken Parrish is.
Morning.
Good morning, Alex.
We should be ready in about 10 minutes.
Sorry, folks, the experiment's off.
Ken's speech.
Great, so. I don't suppose you know where he is.
No. I just called his apartment. He's still not there.
So what are we supposed to do?
Yeah, there's nothing we can do till this thing gets settled. Might as well call it a day.
Have I slept all day, or are you home awfully early?
They've shut us down.
Dr. Parrish's residence.
Yes, Joe. Father Ryan, please.
Hello?
Joe, it's Alex Carmody.
Hey, how are you doing?
Just fine, thanks. Listen, I was wondering if you'd like to come over and have dinner with us tonight. Nothing fancy, you know, just the family.
You kidding? I never turned down the chance of a home-cooked meal. Hey, I'm glad you called.
I was hoping to hear from you.
Yeah, well, there's something I want to talk to you about, Joe.
What do you know about Fatima?
on, Alex. Get off the phone.
We're at 1128 Pinedale. It's the last house on the block.
First and 10.
Oof. All right, fine. You bring the material and we'll supply the food. See you around 7. Thanks, Joe. What's all this?
Well, this is some material I found in the library about Fatima.
Really?
It's not quite as much as it looks like, though. There's a lot of small references, but they're pretty much the same.
Yeah, it's great. I was just talking to a friend of mine about it. You did a lot of work on this, Brian. Thanks. I appreciate it.
No problem. This is part of my genius. Did you know that she was supposed to have predicted World War II?
No, I didn't know that. Just about the great sign.
But that was it. That was supposed to be the signal that the war was coming. Look, I found this article by a Dr. Sturmer about a huge aurora over Europe in 1938.
Let's see.
Oh, and this other article, by a Dr. Andrews, more recent, from 1982, says it wasn't a normal aurora borealis at all, but something unnatural. Maybe even the great sign predicted by Fatima, quote unquote.
Really? I've heard of this Sturmer. He's Swedish, I think, but long gone. Who's this guy Andrews?
Well, it says he's a fusion energy consultant. Mm. Now, he thinks it was more like the effects of an atomic bomb in space.
Excuse me. Hello?
Alex. Hi, it's Jackie. Ken's just gone to the lab.
How long ago did he leave?
About 10 minutes. Alex, be careful. We're under surveillance. They followed him, and there's a car still outside watching my place.
Dad, have you heard about the red spots?
Okay, Jackie, you sit tight. I'll see if I can catch him. I'll call you back. Bye.
I was trying to explain about these red spots.
Yeah, I know. Look, I got to go back to the lab for a while. Tell Mom I'll call her later.
Well, why don't you take these with you?
No, no, you hang on to them. I'll read them tonight. And Brian, thanks again. See you later.
Sure.
Glad you could join us, Dr. Carmody. Dr. Parrish. I think you know everyone here. Dr. Asante, Dr. Beale.
And this is Mr. Grissom. Please have a seat.
May I ask the purpose of this meeting?
You can ask. Our purpose is to advise you of our preliminary decision concerning your recent conduct. We cannot ignore serious security violations. You will not be dismissed. But you will, however, only be allowed limited access status to sensitive materials pending the outcome of the official inquiry. I hope that meets with your approval, Dr. Carmody.
Come on, Nat. I can understand you rapping his knuckles for beating a dead horse in public, but like I said before, there's been no security breach.
He made public something he saw in a classified government experiment in this laboratory. That is a security breach.
No offense, Nat, but that is a lot of hooey. There's nothing new about Ken's theory. It's been knocked around since the Manhattan Project. You said so yourself on TV.
It's okay, Alex. Nat's just doing what he thinks he has to do.
Thanks. There's one more thing we need to discuss.
Dr. Carmody, we'd like your assessment of Dr. Parrish's nuclear tornado theory.
Well, since Dr. Parrish is already aware of what I think, I must say it seems highly unlikely. I mean, most of us would now agree that it would require a combination of physical laws we know nothing about.
Are we claiming to know everything there is to know about nuclear physics? When did that happen? I must have missed it.
Come on, Ken, that is not what I meant. I'm saying that a dynamo or tornado effect is only feasible if a runaway ever got started, but the temperatures necessary to start it would have to be in the order of 1 billion degrees or more.
Such temperatures are possible.
But nothing has ever been established at that high.
Such temperatures are possible.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, please.
Look, there's a simple way to find out. Let us run the experiment to its conclusion. Or better still, Nat, let us run a new experiment at nuclear temperatures on the big accelerator with confining magnetic fields. Right now, we're only guessing.
All right, you can start tomorrow. We'll authorize whatever you need. Except the use of a multi-MEV accelerator and on condition that Dr. Parrish is excluded from the experiment.
Professor.
Come in, look.
You know, we're fresh out of spinach, Popeye. You want to take us out to dinner tonight?
No, honey, I can't. We go again on the experiment first thing in the morning. I still got a lot to do. Oh, my. That must be Joe Ryan. I forgot to tell you, I invited him for dinner tonight, huh?
What, the priest?
It's him. I'm sorry. Now, don't worry. You stall him a while, I'll get some Chinese food.
What am I supposed to say to him?
Try, bless me, Father, for I have sinned.
Hey, Dad, did you know that Father Ryan here was in Vietnam?
No. Were you a chaplain there?
Yeah, a naval chaplain. 26 months.
Really?
It's like another lifetime.
Mm-hmm. This must be the friend you were talking to about Fatima.
Fatima? As in the miracle of Fatima?
Yeah.
What's that got to do with anything, huh?
It came up during some research we're doing, just background, really.
You know, Alex, when you told me that, you really surprised me. It isn't often that the Blessed Mother and hardcore science come in touch with one another.
Well, I'm not so sure that that's the case this time either, Joe. We were checking for comparable spherical waves that occur in the atmosphere during a man-made nuclear explosion. We call them red spots.
And one of them the computer referenced was an aurora borealis that occurred over Europe in 1938.
Well, I still don't see what that's got to do with Fatima.
Well, look, Mom, there was this Dr. Andrews who wrote an article about it. Now, he said that the display of northern lights may have been this great sign that was predicted during the miracle of Fatima in 1917.
What a great sign.
Well, you know, the great sign.
Well, I don't know how much you know about this, Diane.
Well, I've heard about Fatima.
Well, it's believed that the Blessed Mother appeared to three children in Fatima, Portugal.
On top of a bush or a tree or something, wasn't it?
That's right. She made a total of 6 monthly appearances. That was in 1917, some 6 months before the end of World War I. The main message of Fatima is kind of simple, I guess, that unless the people of the earth gave up their sinful ways and returned to worshiping God in their true hearts, he would chastise us again with a second war, more terrible than the first.
Mm-hmm. And that's where the great sign comes in, see? Right, Father Ryan?
That's right. Diane, do you mind if I ask you a question? Could I have some more of that deep-fried seaweed?
Thank you.
Father, do you mind if I ask you a question? When was the last time you ate?
You know, when you called me, Alex, I looked up the memoirs of Lucia, the only one of the three children who's still alive. And here's a direct quote from her. She reports Our Lady told her, "When you see a night lit up by an unknown light, know that it is a sign God gives you that he is about to punish the world."
May I see that?
Sure.
Why pick on something as commonplace as a display of northern lights and call that a message from God? I mean, wouldn't you say, Joe, that today that's kind of reaching?
Yeah, well, I guess it might be considered a case of 20-20 hindsight.
I'll say.
But at first, this was no ordinary aurora borealis, correct, Alex?
That's right, Ann.
And then, Diane, consider the timing. Our Lady warned that this sign would occur during the reign of Pope Pius XI. And guess who was Pope in 1938?
Not Pius XI.
I'm afraid so. And shortly thereafter, Hitler annexed Austria. Moreover, Lucia said at the time, in 1938, that this was not an aurora borealis, and that someday a scientist would prove that it was not.
Mm-hmm. That's what Dr. Andrews did. He wrote that article about it.
That's right. And now, Alex, you tell us that you have more evidence to back that up.
Well, I'm not so sure, but at least I found something that might, you know, call for more investigation into the whole thing.
Well, what was that?
Well, we compared a graph of an upper atmospheric atomic test that took place in 1958 with a graph of the aurora borealis we're talking about, and except for a difference in size, they were pretty much identical.
Are you trying to say that somebody set off an atom bomb in 1938?
No. But if we were to see that kind of a display now, we might think so. Everyone knows there was no atomic bomb in 1938.
You know, what interests me about this Fatima thing, Joe, is that you seem to believe it.
Well, as far as the church is concerned, it's considered a true miracle, one that's worthy of belief. But one which each of us as individuals is free to accept or not.
And where do you stand?
I choose to accept.
Personally, I have to tell you that I have a hard time swallowing it. I mean, look, three little kids full of Bible stories convince themselves that they see something that simply is not there. Now, as a psychology major, Joe, I can tell you that that is not a miracle. Kids do that all the time.
Come on, Diane, take it easy.
No, no, Diane's making a good point. And under ordinary circumstances, I'd be forced to agree with her. But whatever Fatima was, it certainly was not ordinary. But particularly in the light of the final event. Do you know about that, Diane? It was witnessed by at least 70,000 people.
The miracle of the sun, Mom.
Yeah, the thing about Fatima is it's the only instance in recorded history when a miracle was predicted for the exact time and place it was to occur. Yeah, the children had begged for a miracle as proof that these were indeed messages from heaven. And the promise of the miracle had spread far and wide. All kinds of people came. Atheists, agnostics, theologians, journalists, the rich, the poor, you name it, they were all there. And on October 13, 1917, at noon, the miracle occurred.
And what happened, Joe?
Well, stories differ, but it had been raining continuously and heavily for hours. There was up to 3 feet of water in certain areas. People were ankle deep in the mud. All of a sudden, the clouds parted, the rain stopped, and the sun appeared. As I described, like a dull disk in the sky. People could look directly at it easily. Then the sun began to dance in the sky in a kaleidoscope of colors. Suddenly, it began to plummet towards the earth. People fell to their knees, thinking it was the end of the world. People's clothes were all dried up. No one was hurt. And just as suddenly, the sun reversed itself and went back into orbit.
Don't you think that emotion colors what people see? Don't you think those people wanted to see a miracle?
Oh, some, no doubt. But as I said, there were non-believers there as well. And one of the more prominent atheists was the editor of one of the largest newspapers in Lisbon. He wrote a front-page account the next day, describing in detail what he saw.
Joe, weren't the Russians somehow involved in the story?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's the part I find most intriguing. I found this quote, too. In order to prevent further punishment to the world for its crimes, I shall come to ask for the consecration of Russia. Then Our Lady warned that if enough people don't pray for Russia's conversion, in her words, Russia will spread her errors throughout the world, promoting wars and persecutions. The good will be martyred, and various nations will be annihilated.
Yeah.
Sounds like right-wing American propaganda to me.
Yeah, I find it disturbing too, Diane. But remember, this was written in 1917, before the Russian Revolution.
In other words, forget it. God has already decided to turn out the light.
Oh, no, Diane, no. It's just the opposite. The message of Fatima is really a message of hope. I mean, we're given a choice, aren't we? Start acting like God's children should act or face the consequences. Hey, I'm weighing on a bit thick, aren't I? Excuse me, Diane. I'm sorry, Alex. I probably gave you a little more than you asked for.
Not at all, Jim. In fact, you answered a lot of my questions. Thank you. May I keep these?
Please.
Thank you.
Say goodnight to Brian?
Yeah, a few minutes ago. He's really excited about all this Fatima stuff.
Alex, you're not beginning to believe all this stuff, are you?
Believe all what stuff?
This Fatima stuff.
Now, something did happen there. There's no question about that. A lot of people were impressed by it. There's no question about that either.
Darling, you're a scientist. Mystical mumbo-jumbo, don't you think?
You want to hear some real mystical mumbo-jumbo? Science requires that you believe that somehow we're all glued to this giant ball of mud suspended out in the middle of nowhere with no visible means of support in this incredible void that has no beginning and no end. How do you like them apples?
Everyone all set?
Go.
All right, let's hit it.
Tape is rolling.
And just a reminder, folks, especially to our visitors, do not look directly into the chamber. Use the monitors. Thank you. Dr. Alexander Carmody, test number 2, May 3rd, 10:17 a.m. Temperature at low range, infusion process. Jackie?
Magnetic field perfectly stable.
All right. Earl, start the accelerator.
Accelerator is at high voltage.
Right.
300,000 volts.
Inject argon and deuterium.
Injecting. 10 to the minus 4. 10 to the minus 3.
And turning on RF heating. Inject the beam.
Ion and electron temperatures as before.
Right. How's the RF, Earl?
No change here.
Increase voltage. Cut off argon feed. Increase deuterium feed. What's the reading, Earl?
400, 500, 600 kV.
Look, Alex, we're getting a fast temperature rise.
Alex, I'm also getting a temperature rise here.
Again, the ions are running away from the electrons.
Doppler broadening up to 5 million degrees and rising.
The ions are running away with the electrons.
What's happening?
It's all right. You've got a significant ion temperature shift.
How significant?
The ions are a factor of 100 hotter than the electrons. There.
Alex, we're getting neutron flux approaching one dose.
Decrease the flux or shut it down.
No, not yet. Everyone stay calm.
Doing? Don't look into it, Alex. Grissom, call the doctor. Get him in here.
No, no. It's all right. I don't need a doctor. Alex, we're getting a runaway ion temperature. Cut the RF. Reduce the gas speed. Cut the accelerator. Shut everything down.
Sure you're not in pain. Can you see all right?
I'm fine. Believe me, I'm okay.
You'll see the doctor anyway.
It's not necessary.
Did you see? It was self-maintained for 5 seconds after we shut down.
Check. Rewind for playback.
Don't touch it. I want the lab sealed.
Don't touch a thing. I'm sending the graphs and tapes for analysis. And no one is to say a word about this. Understood?
Unless I tell you otherwise. This didn't happen.
What are you saying, Dad? It did happen. We've got a problem.
The experiment was misleading and inconclusive.
Then why are you confiscating the data?
It's called procedure.
You can't put a lid on this.
Just watch me.
Oh, come on, Nat. We got a solid result here. You saw it yourself. Don't make me go over your head.
Go any way you like, but first you'll see the doctor.
All right. Everybody but Jackie out. Rewind the tape.
Jersey's here now, not looking too happy. Thanks, Jackie. I'll call you later. Hi, honey.
Hi.
Hey, Doc. Hey, not a good day at the office, I see.
I'm afraid not. Where's Brian?
Oh, he took the car. He's off somewhere. Jackie called me. She told me all about it. What are you going to do?
I don't know. I tried going over Weiss's head, but I just got the runaround.
She said your experiment this morning turned up some pretty heavy stuff.
There's something going on over there. I'm not sure what. But they reclassified the experiment top secret and sealed up my lab.
Sounds like you scared the pants off somebody, honey. Maybe they figure you've gotten into an area that's best left alone.
No, it's not that. I know Weiss. He'll stop an experiment if it's costing too much and not going anywhere, but the one this morning rang a bell for him. I could see it in his eyes.
Looks like it hit your gong, too.
Loud and clear. What was it said at Fatima? Whole nations to be annihilated.
Oh, Alex, come on. Alex, you haven't said anything to Weiss or the others about this family
no,
business,
have you? No, of course not. If I had, I'm sure they'd have sealed me up along with the lab. But I'll tell you one thing, hon. Ken's nuclear tornado theory doesn't seem as far-fetched as it did yesterday.
What's happened?
I saw something during the experiment today, but I'm not sure I can explain it.
Try me, honey.
Diane, I looked right into the chamber.
You looked into the hot plasma?
Right into the middle of the hot plasma during the height of the experiment.
Oh, Alex!
It was like someone held my head in the vise and I couldn't move it.
Oh, my God, Alex, have you seen a doctor?
Yes, of course. I'm fine. No pain, no blindness, nothing. You can see for yourself.
What happened?
I looked right into that incredible light that's generated, you know, when things really get rolling. Honey, I haven't told anyone this. And I don't think you should either.
Of course not, darling. But, Alex, you've got to tell me what happened.
I saw a beautiful woman, all in white, and she was weeping. I'm not crazy, honey. I saw her, and I heard her in here.
Hello?
Come in, Alex.
Sorry to bother you, Nat, but I thought now that we've had some time to think it over, we might discuss the next phase of the experiment.
The next phase?
Well, yeah, sure. You said yourself it was inconclusive. I'd like to run it on the big accelerator.
I've had time to think it over, and I've changed my mind, Alex. I think the results we obtained yesterday were actually very conclusive.
Oh, that's great. I'm so relieved. Now, listen, I think we can minimize the danger of a possible runaway chain reaction by careful control of available nuclear fuel, and I've done this workup for you.
Alex, the board have decided to try a whole new approach to this thing. They're turning it over to a new team.
Why?
National security, Alex.
But that doesn't make any sense. I'm not a security risk, and it's my project. I built it up from scratch.
It's a Spring Valley National Research Lab project, Alex, and it's funded by Uncle Sam. You've taken it up to this level. We're changing directions, that's all.
I don't understand. What are you saying? What team? What new direction?
I'm not at liberty to discuss it. It's top secret now.
Don't let them do this to me, Nat. You know damn well what we're on to here.
Alex, it's in the board's hands now.
But you seem to be going along with them.
They know what they're doing, and I agree with them.
You are all insane. It's people like you that make the irrational sound rational, and people like me that give you the ammunition.
That's enough. You're overreacting. Your objections have been noted. I was planning to reassign you, but I think leave of absence on full pay will be best for everyone concerned.
Yeah. I think you're right. I could use a rest.
Sure. Take Diane to Florida for a month. Soak up some sun. Call me when you get back. We'll have something new for you by then.
All right, sure. I'll give you a call.
Grissom.
Okay, what's the story?
They're putting me out the pasture. What have we got left?
They took everything. The graphs, the tapes,
the work.
We've still got access to the central memory, but that's about it.
That may be all we need. Can you still call off the teak blast?
Sure.
Good deal.
What are we looking for?
Ion temperatures at point of blast. Feed this equation in. Jackie. Did you notice anything unusual when you reran the tapes for the last experiment?
Unusual how?
Well, you know what I mean. Anything out of the ordinary?
No. Why?
Just curious, that's all.
Okay. Here we are. It's coming up.
My God.
10 billion degrees. But the deep blast was less than 2 megatons of this kind of...
Jackie, get a hold of Ken. Tell him to meet me outside on the west end of the compound. And don't mention these figures. Just tell him we ran the new equation against the deep blast. I'll be waiting.
Figures against the teak blast?
Yes, I did. And I got an ion temperature of up to 10 million K. I'm afraid your nuclear tornado theory could be quite accurate, Ken, and I'm sorry I was so skeptical.
I don't blame you. The temperatures in a 100-megaton explosion are almost incalculable. Somewhere there's a threshold beyond which all matter becomes nuclear fuel. My guess is anything over 80 megatons under the right conditions.
I think you're right.
From now on, every weapon over 80 megatons is a potential doomsday bomb.
My God, of course. That's why it's top secret.
Damn right. And they use their logic by burying it in some other project.
There's no logic to Armageddon. It's insanity. It's got to be stopped, Ken.
How do you propose to do it?
I think the The only answer is to give him a graphic demonstration. Take an experiment all the way and then somehow get the information out, even if we have to leak it.
Come on, Alex. They could really hang you for doing that. And besides, you might be playing with something that could easily get out of hand. Look, I heard Weiss offered you a leave of absence.
Yeah, 4 weeks with pay.
Sounds more like a bribe. Why don't you take it? When you get back, persuade Weiss to put us both on the weapons team.
Weapons team? Are you serious, Ken?
They're gonna need us, Alex. When they wake up, they'll realize that.
Are you the same guy who was yelling ban the bomb so eloquently at Madison Square Garden a few days ago?
Look, when I opened my mouth, they took me out of the game, and it's awfully hard to win when you're on the sidelines. Okay, I've changed my tactics, not my goal. If we can get on the inside, we can really do something.
I can't believe I'm hearing this from you.
Look, I didn't expect applause, but you better remember one thing, Alex. All of us work for the Pentagon in one way or another, even you. Don't forget it.
Honey, maybe Nat's right. Maybe it is time to take a small vacation.
Where would you like to go?
Oh, any place without reactors or laboratories. Paris, huh? New York. Do I hear it for Paterson, New Jersey? How about the motel down the street, huh?
It's a little hard for me to think about a vacation right now.
How about you two taking a second honeymoon?
Since when did you get so romantic?
Hey, leave the kid alone. It's the best idea he's had all day.
All right, whatever you want, okay?
I'm sorry. I know how late it is, but I've got to see you. Yes, right now, if it's possible. All right, fine. I'll be there right away. Thank you.
Alex, you've been working pretty hard on this thing, haven't you? Under a lot of pressure.
You think I'm cracking up, don't you? No, you could be right, but believe me, I saw her.
I believe you, Alex. I also believe there are a lot of possible explanations for it. Hypnosis from looking into a flickering light.
No, wait a minute. First of all, during an experiment, I have tunnel vision. Nothing, but nothing can break my concentration. I'm trained that way. And secondly, Joe, it is not a flickering light. It's the equivalent of staring into 10,000 noonday suns. There is no possible way that anyone could stare into that solenoid and come away with their eyesight.
Okay, let's say you saw what you think you saw. What's next?
I don't know, but I think I should go to Fatima.
Go to Fatima?
Yes.
Why?
To talk to this Lucia.
What good will that do you?
Joe, if this stuff about Fatima is true, if it has any validity at all, then I've got to know. Because what I'm discovering now really scares the hell out of me. If that was the great sign in the sky back in 1938, why should it look so much like an atomic blast a good 7 years before there was one to set off? If anyone has the answer, she does, Joe. And what else does she know?
Alex, going to Fatima is no problem, but Lucy's a Carmelite nun. The outside world never sees her. I doubt you'll even get to talk to her. Gonna have special permission from the Pope.
Then you gotta get it for me, Joe. Because she's the only one on Earth who really knows, and I've got to know exactly what she was told. Don't you see that?
Well, I'll see if the Cardinal can put in a good word for you.
All right, thanks, John.
Don't hold your breath. The odds are pretty much against it.
That's all right. I'll take my chances. You're a pretty handy guy to have around.
Just don't make any more of these midnight calls. I need my beauty sleep.
It's the last one this week, I promise. Who is this, Joe?
We call him Mickey Mouse.
Who?
He's a Vietnamese orphan that we cared for.
We never knew his real name. He was killed by friendly fire.
I'm sorry. I spent 10 years in a laboratory avoiding Vietnam.
Alex, did you know that at Hiroshima there was a group of priests who survived practically at ground zero and no radiation to this day? Same thing happened at Nagasaki to a group of black friars. The only explanation they have is that they were trying to live the message of Fatima. You may be onto something. Go to Fatima.
Spiritual advisor had a big night, huh?
I did. I think Joe just lost some sleep. Thank you.
Feeling better about things now, hon?
Much better.
Good.
I'm going to Fatima, Diane.
Was that Joe's solution?
No, it's my idea.
I guess you told him about what happened at the lab.
I did, yeah.
And?
He was skeptical, but he didn't put me down.
So, you're going to Fatima?
I've got to talk to Lucia. Because I'm almost certain there's a connection between my experiments and what happened at Fatima.
I won't pretend that I understand any of this.
I don't understand it myself, hon.
Damn it, Alex, you're a scientist. A brilliant one. The most logical thinking man that I know. And now this... If you say that you've got to go to Fatima, then I'll help you pack.
Come with me, hon. We'll go to Fatima together.
No, I don't think so.
Why not?
Look, I'm having a really hard time handling all of this. To tell you the truth, honey, I'm real scared about the way you're behaving.
No, don't be scared. I'm okay, honey. I swear to you, I'm okay. Hold me. Please hold me. Everything's gonna be all right, I promise you. Everything's gonna be just fine.
Jackie?
Hello? Morning, Alex. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you? Listen, Jackie, I have to be out of town for a while on some personal business, but while I'm gone, I want you to do something very important for me.
Alex, I spoke to Diane this morning to see if you were coming in, and she told me you're going to that shrine. How is it the two men I care about most are going daffy?
There is an explanation, believe me. I just don't have time for it right now.
I'm sorry, what can I do for you?
I want you to program a computer graphics for me. Full animation, high resolution, and a global projection. I've done the basic calculations, but I need a strong visualization in real time on nuclear scale. Can you do it for me?
Sure, I can do it, but I don't understand.
I think you will once you get into it.
I don't understand. People are saying you've had some kind of a breakdown. Here's me worried about Ken self-destructing and...
Don't worry about Ken. Turns out he's a survivor after all. Jackie. Please, do your very best on this simulation, okay?
Sure.
Don't worry about me either. I'll be okay.
Hello.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir.
Do you have a reservation for Dr. Carmody?
Carmody, sir?
Yes.
American, sir?
Yes.
Are you staying long, Dr. Carmody?
No, just overnight.
Please sign here.
Okay.
May I have your passport?
Are there any messages for me?
Messages? Yes. Do you speak Portuguese?
No, I'm afraid not.
May I read it for you?
Of course.
Father Francisco called. Your guide will meet you tomorrow morning.
Oh, good. Did he say what time?
6 o'clock. Sir.
No, I mean, what time will the guide meet me tomorrow morning?
Si. Tomorrow morning, sir. Paulo will lead you to your room, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Yes.
I am Jacinta, your guide.
Oh, a pleasure to meet you. Sit down, please.
Okay.
And call me Alex.
I recognize you immediately.
Really? How's that?
I saw your picture in the cover of Newsweek. Father Ryan, he told me to say that. You like?
I like. Would you like some coffee or something?
No, thank you.
All right, listen, I've rented a car for us so we can leave for Fatima this morning.
Don't you want to see Lisbon? It's a beautiful city.
No, thanks. I've only come to see Fatima and talk to Sister Lucia. So if it's all right with you, I'd like to get started right away.
Lucia, didn't they tell you nobody can see Lucia without the Pope's permission?
I know that, but Father Ryan's cardinal has contacted the Bishop of Fatima and he knows I'm coming. You see, it's very important that I talk to Lucia herself as soon as possible.
Then we have this big square, which is twice bigger than St. Peter's Square in Rome. And now there is not many people, but always from the 13th of May to the 13th of October, every 13th, many pilgrims from all over the world come over here. Nearly 1 million people. And Tomorrow they start to arrive. Tomorrow the 12th they start to arrive in anticipation. And they have this big procession of the candles. It is very moving. And then, of course, the 13th they have the mass outside. In front of us, it is the Basilica. It was built on the spot where the children were playing when Our Lady made the sign in the sky. And this is the exact spot where Our Lady appeared in 1917, where the statue of Our Lady is. And behind it is the little chapel, the Capellina, which was built in 1919. It was bombed by the unbelievers, and then it was rebuilt again exactly the same year. The big enclosure, it was built only in 1982 to protect the pilgrims from the winds and the rain. They are now saying the rosary, because Our Lady said to say the rosary, and is in the message of Fatima. You want to go and pray inside?
Well, no, thanks. I think we should go now, don't you?
I don't understand. You are not moved?
Forgive me, I didn't come here to be moved. I came looking for answers, and there's really nothing here for me. I'd like now to go and see Sister Lucia at the Coimbra. Yes.
In Coimbra?
Yes.
We go now?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Everything all set?
Mother Superior has gone to talk to Sister Lucia. You will not be able to see her. But at least she will know that you are here.
That's not going to do any good. I got to talk to her.
See, Mother Superior, Dr. Carmody está aqui.
Irmã Lucia sabe porque ele está aqui. E ela diz que rezará por ele.
Dr. Carmody, Sister Lucia knows why you are here. She is going to pray for you.
Yeah, well, say thank you for me, but please tell her it's urgent I speak with Sister Lucia.
Ele diz, muito obrigada, mas realmente precisava falar com a irmã Lúcia com muita urgência.
Diga-lhe que tem que voltar a Fátima, à capelinha, e reze para que seja iluminado. Depois saberá. Eu dou-lhe isto.
Sister Lucia says you must go back to Fátima and pray for guidance in the capelinha. And then you will know. And she gives you this.
Adios, Dr. Carmody. God bless you.
For you.
Oh. all this stuff going?
To a big accelerator.
They didn't waste a second. No, they didn't. Hello, Ken.
Mr. Tyler. I might have guessed they'd give it to you.
Well, you better.
Well, you and Alex, we got a pretty spectacular result with his experiment.
Well, you boys pushed her further than anybody ever thought she'd go. Of course, now it's a totally different ballgame.
I take it you've read Alex's data?
Not yet, but I will. See, I understand you and Alex had a little misunderstanding over this. Is that right? Well, as long as you don't bring your problems into my lab. Understood?
Is that an invitation?
If you like. And Alex, too. In fact, I'd like to have Alex's whole team monitor the experiment. Well, come on, Ken, what do you say?
I say yes, if you can get me off limited clearance. I can't answer for Alex.
Making a connection, he's heading for the city. Russian embassy. I'd like to see the ranking diplomat, please.
I'm sorry, Dr. Carmody. This is not a diplomatic passport.
I know that. But I'm a nuclear physicist at Spring Valley. It's urgent I see someone in authority here.
One moment, please.
Thank you.
This is the American Dr. Carmody. Da-da-da. Stairs on your right. Someone will meet you there.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, you must leave your back here.
Oh.
Thanks.
Yuri!
Alex!
What are you doing here?
This is my embassy.
I know that. I mean, I didn't expect to see you in Paris.
Nor are you. I am here for the disarmament conference.
Oh, really?
But you, is this a formal defection?
Hardly.
Although my escorts out front probably think so.
So how can I be of service?
Yuri, you can be of service to the whole world if you can help prevent this test.
I am afraid, Alex, that decision doesn't rest with me.
All right, who do I have to see? I'm serious, Yuri. You know me. You know I'm not a scaremonger.
But I'm uncovering data now, which means no more nuclear testing for anybody, period. This single blast could be catastrophic to the whole world, and I'll go to Moscow if I have to.
Come with me. Dr. Alex Carmody.
How do you do, sir?
Professor Pietro.
Chairman of the Scientific Council.
Yuri Ivanovich, I will see you later.
Thank you, Yuri.
Thank you, Alex.
You will take coffee, or you will take tea?
No, thank you, nothing, Professor. I'd like to get right to the point, if I may. Sir, I'm here on my own to plead with your government to halt this Barents Sea nuclear test, at least until I've had a chance to complete my experiment.
Professor Carmody, if my memory serves me correctly, your president and our party first secretary have been considering this issue for some time now.
Surely, if two such splendid statesmen are unable to resolve it, what hopes are there for the likes of you and me?
Professor, I've been conducting a series of simulated nuclear tests.
Yes, I know. Your nuclear tornado scenario.
Exactly.
Alas, our scientific committee has already discarded the idea as being technically invalid. Merely more propaganda.
No offense, sir, but frankly, I could care less what any scientific committee thinks at this point. I am bound morally to tell you that with the increased efficiency of the new bombs, there is a damn good chance that this 85 megaton explosion might well trigger a nuclear tornado in the atmosphere, and that in turn could start a runaway chain reaction. I am willing to give you all the data necessary to run the simulation yourself. The rest is up to you.
You're taking a considerable risk coming here.
Not nearly as considerable as the risk you're taking.
Please.
Dr. Carmody, I asked Dr. Laporta to leave just now for a very good reason.
He's an excellent scientist, but a terrible politician. I consider myself to be an able politician, but a not so able scientist. Perhaps you will permit both persons to answer you.
Of course.
The politician in me states officially that your coming here is an unfortunate mistake, that we will continue our testing as planned, just as America is planning to continue her Star Wars testing. Why do you not convince your own people first?
Professor, allow...
No. Please, now. I change my hat and lo and behold, the not-so-able scientist who will be pleased to study your data may find it interesting, perhaps disturbing, but probably inconclusive.
If it's more proof you need, at least give me the time.
Not me, Dr. Connery. Politburo.
All right, I'll get the proof. I just hope to God it's not too late.
We are not stupid men, Dr. Carmody. If your country has been invaded as often as ours, you too would be wary of people placing Trojan horses within your walls.
I understand.
And one word of warning. When you leave here, you take with you only the word, the official word, of man wearing politician hat. Which hat I now take off for you. To you.
Thank you, Professor.
Dr. Carmody. Bill Grissom.
I know, we met before.
Well, I'm outside my formal jurisdiction here in Paris, so I'm only requesting that you allow us to escort you back to the States.
So, officially, I'm not under arrest, but I'm under arrest.
Well, I think that's better than involving the French police, don't you? Mrs. Carmody. Let's go, Alex.
It's all right. We're just going back to Spring Valley. We'll get it all straightened out. Don't worry. Promise
me. You look different. What happened to Fatima?
I'll tell you all about it tonight. I gotta see Father for 1 minute.
Joe.
But thanks for coming. You were right. I didn't get to see Lucy, but I did get my answer.
Good. I had a feeling you would.
You're gonna be home later. I have one more favor.
Sure.
I want you to hear my confession.
Not after midnight, okay?
It's a deal.
Welcome back.
Thanks. I'll see you later.
It's no longer a strategic or ideological question, but one of survival. It's a miracle we haven't blown ourselves straight to hell already, and the Russians aren't fools. They'll listen to us if we can offer proof. We must take the experiment to the limit, even beyond the limit if necessary, to prove the theory one way or the other.
It's out of my hands, Alex. The board's analysis of your data will take weeks to complete.
We haven't got weeks now. You know the Russians are planning an 85 megaton test in a few days, but they know what's going on here, and they'll be watching.
Alex, your actions in Paris were rash, to say the least, but I know your motives were sincere. But at this time, there's no way I can authorize you to continue your tests.
Not good enough now.
It'll have to do.
I want the MEV accelerator as soon as possible.
Out of the question. Jack Tyler's team has the accelerator. As I said, I can't...
You know what I have in mind?
I've got a pretty fair idea, yeah.
Good. How soon can the experiment be ready to go?
Oh, we could go tomorrow morning.
Really?
If you like.
All right. Can I meet you there in a few minutes to go over the game plan?
Right.
I finished the computer simulation. I understand now.
I knew you would.
What can I do for you?
Can you get our team ready by tomorrow morning?
Sure, I don't see why not.
All right. Have them all meet in our lab first thing.
Okay.
I'll see you.
Cigarette?
No, thanks.
Okay, Alex, now look, let's assume that your nuclear tornado has both electrical and magnetic fields. That means even a reverse field configuration is possible.
That's what I'm assuming.
We're following the same line from different directions, Jack.
But if everything leads where I think it does, we all go up in smoke next Friday unless we can stop it.
If we're not real careful, we all go up in smoke tomorrow. What about a safe quench?
Yeah, I've ordered a large tank of krypton gas injected directly into the vacuum chamber for emergency shutdown. It's very stable, and it's not very reactive. That's our safe quench. Now, how about a magnetic quench as well? No. Got it right here?
And what if this malfunctions?
Highly unlikely. In any case, we've got a manual switch over there in the protected area.
Good enough. Tomorrow morning at 11?
Welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Morning, Charlie.
Morning, Doc. Sorry, Doc, I have to do this.
I understand.
Check on Dr. Alex Carmody. Okay, thanks. There you are, Doc.
Thanks.
Have a good one.
You too, Charlie.
Thank you.
They've sent all the equipment over to the big accelerator that's standing by for us.
Good deal.
Well, I guess we are the visiting team in a new ballpark today, so I just want to make sure all of you know exactly what we're in for.
Alex, is it true you want to redline the experiment?
Yes, it's true. We need conclusive proof, and I don't know how else to get it.
Knowing the risk you're taking...
We're all taking the same risk, Jean-Pierre. I don't have to tell you how important this experiment is. You all know what we're facing. There is some danger. There's no point in trying to kid you about that. So, if any of you want out, now's the time to say so. I'll understand.
Well, I'm sorry, Alex. But you will have to do this one without me.
can't jump you. I'm sorry to see you go.
Wish you luck.
Thank you.
No hard feelings?
Of course not. Anyone else?
Well, I'm still with you, Alex, but it's going to leave us a bit short-handed. We got to get another operator. I can't handle the gases, the power, and the cooling.
I know.
How about Ken?
You think he'd do it?
What are you paying?
What do you want?
My picture on the cover of Newsweek.
It's a deal. All right, let's go. Turn on cooling.
Cooling
on. Turn on the motor generators.
Motor generators on.
Increase to 600 volts.
Magnetic field is now established at 50 kilogauss, 10 times stronger than before.
Accelerator ready.
Okay, Charlie. It was 1 milliamp to start with.
We're forming plasma.
Bring the beam up to 10 milliamps.
More plasma now.
Increase the beam to 50 milliamps.
Proton density is growing faster. We have good trapping of protons.
We do have exponential buildup, but it's now leveling off.
We need some microwave heating of the cold electrons. Give me 100 watts of electron cyclotron heating.
ECH 100 watts. Proton density increasing. Leveling off at 10 to the 10th protons per cubic centimeter.
Increase ECH 1 kilowatt.
Up to 10 to the 11th.
Well, let's go 10 kilowatts ECH.
Getting 10 to the 12th protons. I'm also picking up a lot of X-rays.
Full ECH pump.
Magnetic field going negative. Reversal of magnetic and electrical fields. Simultaneous. We have a reversed field configuration.
We better close the shutter, Earl. We'll observe the plasma only through the distant window.
Charlie, it hit the shutter.
Shutter closing.
Leak in a small amount of deuterium along the axis.
Just a tad, Earl.
Injecting deuterium.
Picking up lots of neutron and gamma rays.
We have a nuclear reaction. Increase the deuterium feed.
Alex?
Yes, sir. Do it.
Got a strong negative potential at the axis. We've got an E cross V drive, a plasma rotation.
It's the nuclear tornado.
More like a dynamo.
We've done it.
Alex, we've got too much deuterium.
No, we're okay. Everybody stay on top.
We have a breach in the deuterium gas feed.
We better get everybody out of here.
Seal the containment vessel.
Inject crypto, Alex.
Our safe quench.
Turn off the motor generators. Stop the magnets.
It's not stopping, Alex. It's out of control. We have a freestanding nuclear dynamo.
There's an air leak in the chamber.
You can't stop the reaction. Cut all the gas feeds. Pump it up.
It's no use. It's not low. We've got to get out of here.
All right, everyone out.
Charlie, Marianne, go. Everybody, Mike, Horoshi, go.
Water. It's the fusion energy for water. 6 megatons per cubic meter.
Trying to. Alex, it isn't working!
Don't plug!
Go on, I gotta go! Go!
Alex. I don't believe it.
Neither do I, but I'm not asking for a second opinion.
All that radiation, you should have been burnt to a crisp. It's a miracle.
I know. Is everything all set?
Yes. Here's a script. Jackie put it all together.
Thank you.
Listen, I can still do it if
you... No, it's all right. I have some personal warrants as well.
I ran the tape once. It's pretty scary. Here. You'll need this just to get in there. Only top people allowed in the meeting, Alex. Security is tight as hell.
What about the press?
Not allowed.
That's too bad.
They'll wait. Let's go.
Thank you.
The chair calls upon the distinguished physicist from the United States, Dr. Alex Carmody.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, several weeks ago, my colleagues and I began to encounter a number of significant anomalies during a series of simulated nuclear tests, the results of which were fully substantiated only 3 days ago. Consequently, we are now convinced that the United States and the Soviet Union are running a dangerous risk of returning the globe to dust, not only by premeditated design or careless accident, but by testing as well. With that clearly in mind, we have transcribed our findings onto a videotape in the computerized visualization you're about to see. At T plus 1 millisecond, the 80 megaton blast has exhausted its nuclear fuel and has, because of its tremendous core temperatures, begun to feed on the air and water. At T plus 2 seconds, a self-feeding nuclear dynamo is generated, its chain reactions now unstoppable. At T plus 5 seconds, it is moving at close to 100 miles a minute. In about 7 minutes, it reaches the mainland. Leningrad, Helsinki, and Stockholm are vaporized at T plus 23 minutes. Oslo and Moscow are consumed at T plus 25 minutes. London and Paris are gone 11 minutes later. 23 million people dead, and the dynamo is still gathering strength. It reaches Canada at T plus 60 minutes, and the United States 6 minutes later. Boston and New York are incinerated at T plus 77 minutes. The death toll is now unimaginable. Before T plus 1 hour 47 minutes, most of the northern hemisphere has been engulfed. It is at this point that we hope the nuclear reaction will begin to destabilize and dissipate as the tornado projects itself into outer space. It is equally possible, however, that the reaction could continue until the whole planet has been consumed. We have chosen the more optimistic scenario, yet there is little room for optimism. Those nations that survive the Holocaust will face environmental and genetic effects we can scarcely imagine. The Earth will never be the same again. To quote from a speech in 1948 by Dr. J. Robert Oppenheimer, one of the founding fathers of the atomic age, in some sort of crude sense, which no vulgarity, no humor, no overstatement can quite extinguish, the physicists have known sin, and it is a knowledge that they cannot lose, close quote. As a nuclear physicist, I must acknowledge the truth of that statement, and in reparation, I am compelled to announce my resignation from the Spring Valley Research Laboratories effective immediately. I can no longer contribute in any way to this nuclear arms insanity. The whole world is now aware of what happened with my experiment and with me just a few days ago. Of course, no explanation is possible, but I'm convinced that the hand of God has stayed our ultimate destruction. And perhaps I'm only here now because this infinite power is imploring us once again to stop sinning against each other and against him. Because we are indeed one family, brothers and sisters, all of us, from the same single source. In Genesis, we are reminded of how the world was purged of sin with the great flood. And in Revelations, we are warned of the fire next time. After what we've just seen and heard, there can be little argument among us as to the source of that fire. But there is still hope, and there is still time to act. When he forged the nuclear test ban treaty, which is now in jeopardy, more than 20 years ago, a hope-filled John Fitzgerald Kennedy echoed a simple theme. We all inhabit the same planet, he said. Our children share the same future. And what of that future? The fact remains that a child born today in any part of the world, into whatever society, begins its life in a state of emergency. Thank you.
Thank you.